Macmillan Audio presents Cold Snap by Allison Brennan. Read for you by Kate Udall. Part 1. San Francisco, Saturday, December 22nd. Chapter 1. Patrick Kincaid had a problem. He couldn't say no. Whatever was asked of him, he did it, usually without complaint. He was amicable that way, and his friends and family knew it. He didn't mind helping out. If he could do something for someone, why not? He had a challenging job he liked, a family he loved, and a few good friends who had stuck around, even during his 2-year stint in the hospital sleeping off a coma. Life was too short to be stingy with it. But this time, as he circled the arcane San Francisco streets, which seemed to have no methodology, looking for a parking place in a dense fog, he wished he'd said no. He would have if anyone else in the world had asked him to drive 2 hours out of his way, which took 3 because of the inclement weather, to hunt down a family friend he hadn't seen since he graduated from high school, except at her father's funeral. He'd have found an excuse, or found a replacement. Except it was his mother who had called, and Patrick had never, not once, said no to his mom. His older brother Connor had told him, often, that he was mom's favorite because he was her yes man. His job was to bring Gabrielle Santana home for Christmas. Gabrielle Santana. The girl who'd staged a sit-in sophomore year in high school to protest the expulsion of 3 students who she thought hadn't had a fair hearing with the school board. The girl who'd been arrested at 17 for organizing a rave in an abandoned warehouse in downtown San Diego. The girl who'd been suspended for skinny dipping in the high school pool. Patrick was 3 years older than Gabrielle, but she'd done more her freshman year, both good and bad, than he had his entire 4 years of high school. It didn't help that Patrick had dated Gabrielle's older sister, Veronica, during their senior year, and Gabrielle had often tagged along with Veronica to his baseball games, and even on a couple of would-be dates. The problem was that Gabrielle had called her mother 2 days ago and said something had come up at work and she couldn't come home for Christmas. Now, she wasn't returning her mother's phone calls, or those from anyone else in her family. They were worried. And because the Santanas were worried, Rosa Kincaid was worried. And if Rosa Kincaid was worried and called on one of her children for help, the worry fell onto them. In this case, Patrick. "You're already in Sacramento," his mother had said. "It's not that far out of your way to help the Santanas." She had to have sensed the hesitation in his tone because she gave him the hard sell. And the guilt. Irish Catholic guilt, compounded by the fact that he had a Cuban mother. No one said no to Rosa Kincaid. After 15 minutes of driving around in widening circles, because there seemed to be no street parking in the vicinity, he finally squeezed the rental car into a spot 4 blocks from Gabrielle's loft in a converted warehouse off Howard Street. At least he was driving in a flat area and not the insanely steep hills that made up so much of the city. Patrick pulled up the collar of his jacket against the cold, damp air as he walked briskly down Howard. Lighted garlands wrapped around light posts were the only visible reminder of the holidays. This was a business district, and the thick fog made visibility next to nothing. Some of the apartments above storefronts were more jovially decorated, colored lights framing the windows and small decorated trees. But Patrick had to strain his neck to look up, and honestly, he wasn't in the holiday spirit. His phone vibrated in his pocket, and he pulled it out reluctantly. He hadn't brought gloves. He'd packed for San Diego, where it had been a respectable 78 degrees today, not cold, wet San Francisco. He glanced at the text message from his sister, Lucy. Be glad you're in Sacramento. We're stuck in Denver. Airport shut down. Blizzard. Won't get out until tomorrow night, if then. Love you, Lucy. He responded that he was on an errand for their mom in San Francisco and would be delayed as well, then pocketed his phone and continued up the hill. Maybe this side trip had a silver lining. He wouldn't want to be the third wheel stuck in Denver with Lucy, with her boyfriend, Sean. It would have been doubly awkward. While he'd grown to accept her relationship with his best friend and former partner, Sean Rogan, she was still his little sister. There were some things he didn't want to think about. The fog was so heavy, a layer of moisture quickly coated his jacket. Driving here, he thought of all the reasons why Gabrielle could be incommunicado. Off with a boyfriend. Working. Drinking with her girlfriends. It was selfish and cruel not to respond to her mother's calls for 2 days. But it didn't mean anything was wrong. He'd already checked hospitals and called her employer. Nothing. The only odd thing was that her employer said she would be out of the office until after the holidays. Patrick couldn't get any other details from the snippy receptionist. Again, not being in the office didn't mean something was wrong. In fact, that she'd informed her employer that she would be out told Patrick there was nothing to worry about. Except, he had to talk to her, find out what she was doing, and give Mrs. Santana peace of mind. Give Gabrielle a piece of his mind, too. He would never needlessly worry his mom. He hadn't as a kid, and not as an adult, either. He'd been a cop for more than a decade, and now worked for the private security firm Rogan Caruso Kincaid. When he was going to be unreachable for more than a day, he made sure his family knew his plans. It was common courtesy. He rounded the corner of Gabrielle's narrow street, not wider than an alley. One car could barely squeeze through. The buildings were a mix of very old and newly renovated, mostly businesses, with apartments upstairs. In Gabrielle's converted warehouse, the heavy metal door was accessible only by a keypad. A sign indicated that the lobby was open from 6 a.m. until 6 p.m. Patrick rang her buzzer. No answer. He tried her cell phone number. She didn't have a landline in her name. Again, no answer. He looked around for an external security camera and didn't see any. He easily hacked the keypad, and the door opened. Sean had taught him a lot of tricks over the years, and the former cop and Patrick winced at breaking and entering. Though, as Sean would say, he wasn't breaking anything. It took Patrick a few moments to get his bearings. First, he was surprised at the quiet. Even the traffic from the interstate a few blocks away had dimmed once he'd stepped inside. Music faintly played from somewhere upstairs. The lobby was a small square with a flocked Christmas tree in the center covered with blue and green glass balls. It looked fake. Christmas had always been Patrick's favorite time of year because his parents went all out. They didn't have a lot of money growing up, but Christmas was the time for making presents, eating far more than was healthy, and spending time with family. Decorating the Kincaid family Christmas tree, which they cut down themselves every year, was a party in itself. You'll be home for Christmas. This is just a small delay. 16 mailboxes were built into the wall. 8 of them were larger boxes labeled with business names, a realtor, an interior decorator, and similar white-collar professionals. The other 8 were narrow and had last names only. Bruce Carmichael. Santana, in Unit 12. Though the warehouse had been completely built out, the industrial feeling remained cold and sterile, like the fake tree. the polished concrete floors and modern metal staircase might be seen as hip and trendy, but they contributed to the lobby's icy interior. The building seemed lonely, if a building could feel anything. On the second landing, he found Unit 12 in the far back corner. He knocked on the door and silently swore, shaking out his sore knuckles. Solid metal. He rang the bell. No one answered. Patrick tried the door, not expecting it to open, but it did. Gabrielle left her apartment unlocked? Even in a semi-secure building, he'd never leave his door open, especially in the middle of a major city. He pushed open the heavy door and glanced around before entering. The entry was small and narrow, only the light from the corridor casting a glow in the dark. He called out, "Gabrielle? Hello?" Then felt along the wall and found a light switch. The entryway and living room brightened. A short staircase led to the large central room with lush, bright throw rugs tossed haphazardly over the cement floor. The exterior walls were brick. One was embedded with small, square warehouse windows. The other was dotted with bright and wild contemporary art. The raised, galley-style kitchen included a long, low bar with two benches. The ceiling was more than 30 feet high. A spiral staircase led to a loft above the kitchen. Small, but the towering ceiling and wall of windows made it seem much bigger. Standing in the middle of Gabrielle Santana's apartment, Patrick felt like an idiot. Nothing appeared out of place. Two mismatched couches that looked comfortable. Several beanbag chairs. Scuffed coffee table covered with books and magazines. He tilted his head. One side of the table was definitely shorter. "Gabrielle," he called out. "It's Patrick Kincaid from San Diego. Your door was open." Nothing. The living room was just that, no work or desk area. He smiled as he approached a small tree on a corner table. It was a Charlie Brown tree, spindly and half dead, a string of lights draped across and plugged into the wall, tinsel and a popcorn string. A star, too heavy for the tree, leaned precariously on the top. He didn't want to roam through Gabrielle's home. He went into the kitchen and rummaged through a couple of drawers before he found a sales flyer. He turned it over, pulled a pen from his pocket, and started writing a note. What was he going to say? To phone home? To call him? He jotted down his name and number and put it under a magnet for Chinese takeout on the refrigerator. Still, the unlocked door made him nervous. He went upstairs to the loft to make sure there was no sign of foul play. The loft was divided into two long, narrow rooms, both of which looked down into the living room at different angles with a connecting bathroom. One was Gabrielle's bedroom, one her office. Gabrielle's bed was unmade, clothes strewn all over a chair in the corner, makeup and other girl things covering the long, scratched dresser. In the den was a couch. A pillow and sleeping bag were tossed to one end. Company? But there was no blood, no sign of robbery, no sign of anything amiss. He went back downstairs just as Gabrielle. Wow! She'd gone from stunning to gorgeous, but he'd have recognized her anywhere. Was running up the short staircase from the entryway. She glanced at him, dark eyes wide with shock, then turned and ran back out the front door. "Gabrielle, it's Patrick Kincaid." His words were cut off by the metal door sliding shut. Damn, damn, damn. He'd scared her, and that made him feel like shit. He ran after her. As soon as he opened the door, something hit him on the side of his head and he stumbled. Something hard pressed against his back. On instinct born from years of training, he kicked his legs, rolled over, and flipped his attacker. His hand grabbed the wrist that held the weapon he knew wasn't a gun. It was a cell phone. Damn it, Gabrielle! It's Patrick Kincaid. She stared at him blankly. He jumped up, holding out his hand for her. She didn't take it. A cell phone will protect you better if you call 911. Recognition finally replaced her stunned expression. She got up on her own and grabbed her phone from his hand. Patrick? Kincaid? What the hell are you doing here?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.